to this latest in the series of BN Ganguli Memorial Lectures that we hold every year. I must say that of all the events that we have, the Ganguli Memorial Lecture is one of the closest to our hearts. It's really quite dear to us, not only because we have managed to maintain the highest quality of lectures, but also because of its format. It is, of course, a public event, which is to say that, like all other public events, it's on issues that concern all of us at least, who are interested in them. And it's accessible to everybody. There is unrestricted access. It's not limited to academics do you want to sit?
No, of course they want to sit.
But when you say that you've organized a public event these days in our own times, you begin to think about the electronic media, not only the print electronic media, the radio, the TV, the internet. I mean, this is an ever-expanding universe. And it's precisely because it provides such a contrast to that that this becomes a really, really nice and endearing event. Because here you have face-to-face interaction. It's direct. It's unmediated. It's vivid. The person stands before you and speaks, speaks to you. That's really what makes it's not a classroom. It's not a discussion. It's just 1 hour of good speech, which everybody must pay attention to here. I mean, in that sense, it has some resemblance with the, although it doesn't carry any of that hierarchical baggage, it does have that old association with traditional sermons and even teachings. So what one associates is a banyan tree and a really important thinker, standing below the tree, and a lot of the people who are simply interested coming and listening. And this is such a, in some ways such an archaic idea, or such an ancient idea, that to contrast it with, and to call it a public event, and it fulfills the criteria of all the public events. So it's to contrast it with all that is happening in the global world today, and to see this nice public event, which is so direct and, as I said, so face to face. It's such a pleasant thing. And the speaker shares his or her thoughts. And, it's a direct address to everybody to join in the exercise of thinking with the speaker. And I think this is really a wonderful, something like that to happen in our very mediatized times. This is really quite pleasurable. So I'm really glad that Dipesh is here. We've had very, very eminent people speak before, and he is as, if not more, eminent as any of the speakers who spoken before him. I've got a long list, but I won't repeat all those great speakers who have been here in the past. And I won't talk about Dipesh. I will leave that to Tonika. Although I must say that I'm really, really delighted that Dipesh is here. This has been planned for many years, 2 years, I think. But let me introduce our chair, Tonika Sarkar, who's well known. I don't have to say very much about her. She's a professor of modern history at the Center for Historical Studies at the Jawaharlal Nehru University. Among her many books are Bengal, 1928 to 1934, The Politics of Protest, Words to Win, A Modern Autobiography, Hindu Wife, Hindu Nation, Community, Religion, and Cultural Nationalism, Women and the Hindu Right, a collection of essays that she edited with Urvashi Bhatalia, and Rebels, Wives, Saints, Designing Selves and Nations in Colonial Times. But, I mean, none of this list really tells about the quality of Tonika's work and her dedication to the art of history writing. I mean, that's something which cannot be conveyed simply by talking about the books that she's written and so on. So I'm really delighted that she's here to chair this talk. And Sean Tonika, the floor is yours. It's up to you. You can sit there or you can come.
Thank you, Rajiv. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Dipesh Chakrabarty here, and we are all very thankful to CSDS for organizing this year's Ganguli Memorial Talk with Dipesh here. You know, cliches sometimes do have substance, and none more than this, that Dipesh Chakrabarty needs no introduction, especially from me. But Rajiv said I should hold forth for some time, and I mean to do so, really to annoy Dipesh Chakrabarty more than anything else. Now, Professor Chakrabarty had rather an interesting trajectory as a student. He did his undergraduate degree in physics from Presidency College, Kolkata. He then went on to do a degree in business management from Indian Institute of Management, Kolkata. Then he went to the Australian National University, Canberra, and did a history PhD on jute mill workers of Calcutta under the supervision of DLO, I think. Yes. He has long been a member, a very distinguished member of the Subaltern Studies Collective. He has also worked in the Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Calcutta. He is a co-editor of Critical Inquiry and a contributing editor, Public Culture. He has recently been given, he refuses to tell me which exact year it was, he has been awarded the D.Lit degree by London University. He is right now that is what I have to look up, Lawrence A. Kimpton Distinguished Service Professor of History and South Asian Studies at the University of Chicago. His first monograph, Rethinking Working Class History, came out in 1989 from Princeton University Press, and it literally turned the world of or the practice of labor history around. It studied the structure of industry and management as well as the structure of the labor force. It introduced a much-needed cultural turn, though a very controversial cultural turn, to labor studies. And above everything else, it generated enormously important, rich, and stimulating debates around labor, which really left the field completely changed since his time. And the debates still go on, even though he himself has exited from the field. Provincializing Europe, Postcolonial Thought and Historical Difference came out from Princeton in 2000, and the name itself has attained a proverbial status. To my mind, it is certainly the most nuanced and complex approach to this problem of the intellectual cultural relationship between the West and the colony that perennially haunts postcolonial studies. It brings together the theoretical abstract and the concrete historical, and it reevaluates both in the light of his own experienced world, and that's a very important thing about Dipesh Chakrabarty's writings. Habitations of Modernity, Essays in the Wake of Subaltern Studies came out in 2002, and there is a large number of writings and on subjects as varied as climate change and Bengali literary identity. To each of these, he brings his very distinctive stance, his very individual and unusual mode of address. And finally, this may be something that may be a bit of news to many of you, he is an equally accomplished author in Bangla, a poet, an essayist, a composer of songs that are both wicked and beautiful. His current work is on Sir Jadunath Sarkar, a giant among historians of his generation, and I think there could be no two historians as unlike each other in their intellectual approach as Sarkar and Chakrabarty. And he has already published a marvelous imagined dialogue between the two of them, and I think the talk he's going to present right now is going to carry on that dialogue. So over to you.
It'll work, no? Yeah. Just leave it here. I mean, we'll always get it back. Well, thank you very much, Rajiv, for the original invitation and also the warmth with which you've always welcomed me. And thank you, Tonika, who is really very dear friend from my undergraduate years. For that very warm note of introduction, and thank you to all of you for coming. If there is, or if there was a bunion in this room, it would be B.N. Ganguli, and we would be all, you know, the growth from that bunion tree. My talk doesn't connect directly with B.N. Ganguli's work in any direct sense, but when I was being trained to be a historian, economic history was very important, the history of economic thought was very important. So of course we read B.N. Ganguli, and considering that what I will be talking about is a fragment of a history of knowledge, Indian knowledge, I hope that what I have to say acts as a tribute to his memory and his achievements. I should warn you that that this will probably take the better part of an hour for me to go through this, go through what I have to say. What I'm presenting is really sort of notes from a larger book that I'm on the verge of completing. It's not a biography of Jadunath Sarkar, nor am I doing historiography through looking at him. What I'm trying to do when I ask myself this question, what is it that I'm trying to do, and you know, a book is never done until you've found your answer to that question. I think is really, to put it in a sort of cumbrous way, trying to do a social history of disciplinary practices. In other words, disciplines, there's a level at which different disciplines globally look the same. So a review published in Indian Economic and Social History Review or an article published will have the same apparatus and the look more or less as an article published in American Historical Review. But my argument would be that the concepts, institutions, and institutional practices that make up a discipline, particularly in the social sciences, are actually determined by very contextual debates and are contested in very particular contexts. So that if you ask the question, how does a discipline find a home? Or how does the same discipline that we recognize at the global level, at the same discipline, so that somebody teaching in Delhi University can be appointed without much hassle to teach history, say, in some other university outside the country, because there's similarity at that level. The reason why the discipline finds a home in varied contexts is because its central terms and propositions, its central concepts, central institutional practices, eventually are determined by a series of debates about them. So for history, for instance, I would say if the idea of fact, the idea of historical truth, the idea of doing research in history, the institution of archive, and the institutional practice of doing research, if you consider them to be completely germane to the discipline of history, I would say that you would find that these things have established themselves over time through very different debates in different national or regional contexts. And in some ways, what I'm trying to do by looking at Jadunath Sarkar is try to write a part, because this is not the whole story, a social history of the institutional practices that eventually make up the discipline of history in India, particularly in the years when the discipline was being formed. So the particular idea that I'll deal with here is the idea of research. In other words, to understand what could be a possible history of the activity that gets called researching history. Because the word research, as far as I can see, is of 16th century origins in English. And obviously the word has existed since then, and you can easily think of a journal like Asiatic Researches in the 18th century. The word research didn't have the same meaning all the time. As you know, I mean, Indian universities didn't even produce PhDs in good numbers until the 1930s. Australian universities not until after the Second World War. So this whole question of what is research, in fact, William Clark's book on the history of the research university in the West has a very interesting discussion even of the debates in Germany about 18th century debates about whether or not the highest degree should be a doctorate degree or a master's degree. And the argument was that since we call Lord God our master, there could not be a higher degree than the master's degree. And the doctorate degree should be reserved for doctors. But somehow, through all kinds of historical coincidences, a PhD emerged to be the highest degree in the Western research universities. If you look at 18th century books like, just to give an example, William Franklin, who was a captain in East India Company service, Bengal establishment, and a member of the Asiatic Society, who wrote on the reign of Shah Alam in 1798, he actually describes his book as standing merely on his own researches, and that's 1798. And if you follow the book to see what did he mean by the word researches, then it would see that it's really collecting material on the spot in the way that Grand Duff would have done his research or John Malcolm would have done his research early part of the 19th century. It really meant when going to talking to some people, collecting stories. It did entail a kind of engagement with veracity and truth because, for instance, he debates Alexander Dow's idea that the Awadh ruling family came from a low origin. But it's based on, the debate is based on the other stories that he had collected which contradicted Dow's idea. So here then, the only Foucauldian word that I've used in the title of the lecture is the birth of historical research. Simply to cover my back, because but then I have to tell people that that I have used the word birth. Don't attack me for not having already said what you're trying to say in your criticism. Simply to say that this is not the whole story. There are a lot of other people working at the origins of this discipline called history, and because Foucault's idea of birth, which distinguishes itself from the idea of origins, precisely by meaning by the word birth, many origins, multiple origins. Hopefully I've covered my back against the criticism, why haven't you talked about so-and-so? So the essay, what the essay attempts to do then, or the lecture attempts to do really here, is an ethnographic and not an intellectual history of the birth of historical research in colonial India. For example, I do not ask who first mooted the idea of research among historians in India? I don't ask that. And how was the idea disseminated? There could be an interesting history of, you know, who first talked about it. I'm interested in that question, but the questions of more immediate interest to me are kind of Geertzian in spirit, with a few sociological twists added to them. So my questions would be, how would one write the history of the activity called historical research in the Indian context? What kinds of activity would be designated research, and by whom? So how would you constitute the authority that would actually name something properly as research? In what way would such, what would make this activity socially meaningful to those engaged in it? Why would you value doing what you're calling research? In what way would such social meaning differ from whatever meaning the act of writing history had at a time when writing history was not necessarily the same as researching it? In other words, how would those who initiated research in Indian history distinguish themselves as doing something new, and thus from those they perceived as not doing research, properly so-called? In other words, there's a Bourdieuvian question there. How do you give research value, cultural value? How do you make it into a culturally valued activity for yourself? So why would research, doing research, be a cultural capital for yourself? What makes these questions interesting in the Indian context and in the context of Sir Jadunath Sarkar, I think, that debates about the idea of historical research started among Indian scholars long before Indian history became a researchable subject in Indian universities. So the emergence of Indian history as an area of specialization is actually a much more recent story. So in a way, I'm talking about Jadunath Sarkar and his debates with others, and Sardesai would be involved in the story, at a time when they were not really professional historians. I mean, they were not history professors in universities, but they were debating this idea. So the archive that actually drew me to this question are the 1,300 or so letters that still survive in the National Library in Kolkata from the weekly correspondence that took place between two Indian scholars who saw themselves self-consciously as pioneers of historical research and came to have a formative and fundamental influence on the subject called Indian history. One is Sir Jadunath Sarkar, 1870 to 1958, and the second person is, I'll show you a picture of him, is Rao Bahadur Govind Rao Sakharam Sardesai, 1865 to 1959, the Pune-based historian who originally worked for the Baroda government but took retirement and in 1926 and worked from Pune, from Kamshet near Pune. Sarkar is usually regarded as the doyen of modern Indian history. I don't have to really introduce him to this gathering except to say that his training was actually to teach literature. So most of his working life, he worked as a professor of English literature. Except for the last few years when he taught at BHU, he taught at undergraduate institutions such as the Ripon College in Calcutta, Patna College in Bihar, Ravenshaw College in Cuttack, Orissa. He retired in 1926 when he was appointed Vice Chancellor of the University of Calcutta for 2 years. There's very interesting stories to do with the typical scandals of Calcutta University. You know, this was an anti-Ashutosh Mukherjee fight. He had been writing criticisms of Ashutosh Babu when Ashutosh Babu was an expensive Vice Chancellor, and everybody was giving credit to him for starting all kinds of programs in French departments and German departments without teaching the languages. And German was being taught in English, French was being taught in English, and Jadunath Sarkar used to write very angry letters saying, what's he doing? This is not the way to give education. So they made him the vice chancellor, and of course he had such a tough time that within 2 years he resigned and said, no more of this, and actually focused his time on writing about the history of the Mughal Empire. His volumes on Aurangzeb, Aurangzeb came out between 1912 and 1924, between 32 and 1950. So really in retirement, he wrote the four volumes of The Fall of the Mughal Empire. He wrote numerous other books. In a Bengali piece I wrote quite a while ago, actually, about encountering Jadunath in the archives, which is connected to the friendship between Sardesai, the story about the friendship between Sardesai and Jadunath, was that he wrote a beautiful clear hand, and everybody commented on it. And, you know, I was taking notes because the National Library in Kolkata doesn't allow you to take Xerox copies, photocopies, nothing except for handwritten copies of these 1,300 letters. And my handwriting is pretty bad. And it was terrible, sort of his letter on this side, my copy on the other side. And you know, like how when I write ing, like going, normally there's a slur between in and g. You know, you could read g, g-o, and then my ing would be a slur. Every alphabet stood out. So initially I kind of poo-pooed him, thinking, okay, you had colonial education. You had those sort of exercise books in which four lines were drawn. You learned to write, you know, the alphabet in the proper scribal way. I sort of deny the... But then Sardesai had my kind of handwriting. So I couldn't completely explain by colonial education alone. And finally I bought a pen that would just... with a point that was a little rougher and would produce more friction between the paper and my hand, so that I would slow down. And if nothing else, my handwriting improved in that period, in the 3 months that I was copying out these letters by hand. So the reason it's connected to the story of Jadunath Sarkar and Sardesai's meeting is that Sardesai remembers getting such a letter from Jadunath Sarkar in 1904. Somebody saying, you're working on Maratha histories, you don't know Persian, and I'm working on the history of Aurangzeb, and I know Persian, but I don't know Maratha sources, so why don't we work together? And out of that emerged a friendship that was lifelong for all of the tensions that they inhabited. So his handwriting was of some consequence in his life. And Sardesai himself was not even a university-based academic. He was actually, he worked for the Maharaja of Baroda, but he was, he actually, his life was very interesting because he took retirement in 1926 in order to devote himself completely to historical writing. And he had already written that 8-volume history of the Marathas Riyasat. He was known as the Riyasatkar of this, and then was working on his 3 volumes of, the history of the Marathas in English. And because Baroda didn't want him to resign and retire, his pension that was due to him, which was going to be 200 rupees a month, was immediately slashed to 100 rupees a month. You could do those things in those days. And the poor guy couldn't actually afford to live on in Bombay, where he wanted to live. His brother, who built a hospital, who was a doctor, and built actually a hospital in Kamshet, also had a house in Kamshet. And I'll show you pictures of the house, where Sardesai lived in retirement. So he made those sacrifices. He lived on 100 rupees a month for quite a few years. I think towards the end of his life, the full pension was restored. The interesting thing was that when they reflected back on the letters they'd written to each other, they actually said, both Sardesai and Jadunath said that, okay, let's keep these letters because they will one day tell students of history what research is. So they actually thematized their own correspondence in terms of a meta-commentary on what research was. But the word research was entering Indian languages early in the 20th century. So one finds the voluntary associations claiming to do historical research coming up in 1910, the Bharat Itihas Samshodak Mandal in Pune, and the Borendra Anusandhan Samiti in Rajshahi, and both Anusandhan in Bangla and Samsodok means researchers, are actually direct translations, Anusandhan particularly, from the word research. A few years later, there's Ahom Research Society comes up a few years later, then Bihar and Orissa Research Society around 1914, Karnataka Research Society in the historical research in the 1930s. So actually throughout 20th century, the word research becomes popular outside of the university amongst these people. And therefore, I thought this correspondence was fascinating in terms of being this meta-commentary on what research was. So in fact, when the correspondence, a selection was published as an appendix to a volume that was published to honor Sarkar, Sarkar's foreword to the volume summed up his own life as that of a researcher and emphasized, as the letters of the selection do, a very particular category that was very important for these people, genuine researcher. So research was a contested category from the beginning. And as I said, you know, there was this Borjuvian attempt to give it value. So you have to distinguish between false researchers and genuine researchers. And Jadunath says, in his foreword, he says, when I first set my hand to the plow in 1891, research, except in Sanskrit, meant only the pirating or translation of modern English or French books. But today, no genuine, and he added emphasis to the word genuine, worker in Indian history is content unless he has mastered the language of the original authorities and can utilize original records, dispatches, state papers, inscriptions, which are the primary responsible sources. So what then was research? So research for the Jadunath Sarkar and Sardesai, I would say, was first of all an attempt to reconstruct the past by getting as close to eyewitness accounts as possible. And Jadunath, through his life, particularly emphasized that point, the importance of original eyewitness documents. For instance, he would say, and this is 1915, consider how in writing histories of the Pathan period, we depend blindly on Farishta and Al-Badawuni and on Kafi Khan for the histories of 17th century Mughal emperors, but all three of them were born long after the events and were mere collectors of contemporary descriptions. The second task, he said, was to verify these references. And there's a very interesting colonial kind of lingo that comes into his writing explaining why, what is the eyewitness account. He calls it actually First Information Report, an FIR. Who lodged the FIR, he says. Who made the first report? Has any copy of the FIR been collected? How do we get, I mean, there's something to be excavated there. How do we get copies of confidential police diaries? Does this particular witness have any opportunity to find out about the event? Did he witness the event with his own eyes, or is he repeating what he has heard from others? And finally, it's a very important point, are his interests tied up with those of any of the parties in dispute? So, in fact, the whole idea was, see, I mean, Jadunath did something which I haven't fully thought about, but this idea that you got to the truth by viewing somebody in the round, as it were. So you collected different perspectives, and they cancelled out each other's anomalies. I always find it fascinating because, I mean, just from, you know, as growing up in the country, as you know, we don't normally, when we make images of gods and goddesses, we don't normally complete the images. We leave the side that we are not going to see unfinished. So if you go behind a Durga image or a Kali image, the image is never complete in the round. So I often think, you know, looking at somebody in the round is not what we've normally done. But this idea of truth arising out of looking at somebody in the round was very important to him. Collecting verifying evidence, however, merely was hard work. He said, so that's the labor part, wrote Sarkar, without requiring the application of his special merit. The next step, he said, for the historian, was to avoid personal mistakes by looking at a character in the round, as I said, from many directions at the same time. And finally came the question of the narrative of what Sarkar would call the historian's philosophy of history. But the biggest item in Sarkar's reformist agenda was the question of truth. And I'll have a fair amount to say it. Because he said, it must be the whole and undistorted truth about the past. That must be the ideal. And history must stand, as he put it, on the solid rock of truth. Each of these terms in Sarkar's list, eyewitness account, did they have something to do with, what, something at interest? How do we get at an account that is a disinterested account of the past, that is also truthful? One could say that each of the terms in Sarkar's explanation marked a break with what we might call the Indian tradition of writing history under the Mughals and before. Because India did not have any identifiable archives that survived the British times, that survived into the British times, and Sarkar would actually think a lot about why we did not have an institution called the archive. And you know, all his life, he actually fought to have a public records bill, which we never had until very lately. And there's a very interesting story to be told with his fights in the Imperial Records, in the Historical Records Commission, about the Imperial Records Department, which only got renamed as National Archives. I mean, because our National Archives only means that it's a repository of the records belonging to the central government. It's not a nationalizing archive. It doesn't, you know. But Sarkar was in favor of actually an archive that would be nationalizing. And he was always thinking about why the Mughals didn't leave anything of an institution like that. Interesting answers he gave. And therefore, the insistence on using an original contemporary sources made for an entirely new activity. And there was, and that, you know, which I've written about in some other place, the 19th century saw for the first time real rivalry between people who were all digging for original sources. And sometimes it got so mad in Maharashtra, where tons of original sources were found in sort of historical families, that sometimes people would collect a source or a document and then hide it and then forget where they hidden it. Or if you went into a meeting of the Bharatitya Samshodak Mandal to listen to somebody kind of expostulate on a newly found document, the rule was that you couldn't take any notes. I hope that's the rule today. So I can't imagine historians in pre-British India seeking credit or feeling jealous of each other for being the first to spot an original source. So in a way, research was tied with this creation of new emotions, as you can see. Indeed, as Sarkar himself says, many of the old historical accounts themselves repeated other accounts already available to them. But more importantly, by you have to go and look for sources. So he actually called for, I'm quoting him, hard work, and that researchers must abandon laziness. But by which account he was also making research into an activity of the young, which most historians of the older times were not, by their own reckoning. So in a way, research was being defined as an activity that was mostly to be undertaken by young people. Indeed, one of the most remarkable aspects of the correspondence between Sarkar and Sardesai is a particular strand of their lament over old age that had not so much to do with the disabilities of old age, but more with the fact they were not sort of personally disabled, but the fact that they couldn't stomp around the countryside looking for sources anymore. You know, they had all sorts of fun because Sarkar could read Marathi eventually, but he couldn't speak it. So sometimes he used to go dressed up as a Gunga Marathi Brahmin, because Sardesai was the Karhare Brahmin, and Sarkar would go dressed up as a Brahmin, not speak a word, to get access to documents while they were fighting the Rajwades and the other people from the Pune historians. In one of the letters, for instance, Sarkar writes to Sardesai in 1940, "You probably realize that in view of our advanced age, this is likely to be the last historical excursion we shall undertake together." So the fun of actually looking for sources, the thrill of it, is something that age was barring them from. And I don't think this particular way of experiencing old age would have been available to historians of the Mughal or the late Mughal period. For while histories in the Mughal or the late Mughal period were written often for a variety of reasons, some instrumental, some theological, the work was seldom undertaken as idealistic, youthful activity. Most historians were not young by the reckoning of their own ages. I give some examples here, I'll just skip that in the interest of time. But most historians themselves, and also they wrote, sometimes people wrote it when they were between jobs, for instance. Ishwardas Nagar's Fatwati Alamgiri, dealing with the period 1657-1700, was written when the author was 47 years old, quite old in that time. It was written as an act of secular piety. And he wrote, "After going through my history, the educated may derive intellectual benefits, the illiterate knowledge, the brave inspiration, and the cowards may long to undertake valorous deeds." Or written histories were often, as you know, used to secure favors. Sarkar himself translated, among other things, 3 18th century Persian histories of Bengal Nawabs. One of these, Azadul Husseini's Naubahar-e-Mushrid Kuli Khan, was clearly used by the author as part of an application for a literary position. While Yusuf Ali's Ahwal-e-Mahabad Jang was written as a distraction, he said, to compose my mind, when the author was going through a difficult time brought about by illness, unemployment, father's death, and the danger of imprisonment and confiscation of property. So you actually wrote history. It's like you wrote history to fix your mind on something else. So it was not always pragmatic. But there was, the context was very different. In fact, the very different cultural location of history that these texts enjoyed, it was that location that allowed European administrators and soldiers to collect historical manuscripts in India in the late 18th and early 19th century. So if you actually ask how did people find these manuscripts that end up in the British Library, you'll find that it was the cultural location of these texts that actually enabled the European collections. Histories were often written as gifts to find favors with European officials. Think of the famous Eliot and Dowson 9-volume collection of Muslim histories. Eliot, who was the foreign secretary of Lord Dalhousie, was interested in the history of old families. Gifts of Persian manuscripts pleased him. So, actually Sarkar himself explained this in a Bengali essay. He wrote, "Presenting him with very rare or hitherto unknown historical manuscripts smoothed a passage to his darbar. It could even make it possible to save a small kingdom or increase the pension of a Nawab, Thus, the hapless descendants of the imperial or old courtly families gave Eliot gifts of highly valuable, beautifully written Persian manuscripts preserved in the imperial palace in Delhi. Among them were some of which there were no other copies in the world. Earlier in the 18th century, when the English became the main power in Northeast India, Europeans began to acquire illustrated Persian manuscripts in Lucknow and elsewhere through the force of money and power. And one of the points that actually Sarkar makes is about the European interest in the 18th century in generally in histories of fallen aristocracies. That there's a kind of a European curiosity which they transfer to India, which also leads to collections of histories of families. It would of course be wrong to say that the pre-colonial historians had no concern with historical truth, because otherwise they wouldn't know why would they write history. But being truthful about the past was not the main reason why they wrote history. And that's the point of distinction, that whereas for Sarkar, being truthful itself became a value, just as finding the fact was therefore a derived value. So the older historians wrote to advance different causes in their lives, from the very narrow selfish ones to serving larger religious and other interests. What was new about the idea of historical research that Sarkar and promoted and Sardesai promoted was its absolutely non-instrumental disinterested character, a kind of truth for truth's sake attitude. The joy of his research partook of this pure, that is disinterested, character of the truth being sought, as expressed, for example, in a letter written in 1936, in which Sarkar is described to Sardesai how reading Sardesai's translation of Bhus's March on Pune led him to a restudy of the Maratha accounts of it, and he continued. He said, "I found the Purandare Daftar of such absorbing interest that I stole a day and a half from work on my third volume of The Fall and translated the whole of the account of the expedition given in Purandare and identified all the places." And sometimes in some of the letters he would say, "Eureka, I've actually been able to show where this village was," because there are sometimes villages more, you know, the same names, more than one village. And then he writes, and this is again this new emotion to do with research. "There's an unspeakable joy when one succeeds in tracing every minute movement of a campaign on large maps like those I possess." It's a very significant statement because it leads to the topic of the whole question of having a research library. You know, where you didn't buy books written by Tonika Sarkar and Dipesh Chakrabarty, you bought original sources. That's a research library. So and he was very proud of the maps he had, the sources he had, and I'll come back to that. So Sarkar's presidential speech at the Bengal Literary Conference of 1915 articulated this idealism in a very clear form. He said, "The best method of researching history is the scientific method. Nationalist pride should not lead Indians to dismiss it, simply because," he said, "modern Europeans had adopted it." By pointing to nationalist pride as an obstacle to research, Sarkar was also obviously making the point that the question of methods in scientific history could not be separated from the cultivation of a certain kind of character on the part of the historian. And come to the character, but there are two points to make. One is, why is he saying we must not be swayed by nationalist pride? Because he was seeing a lot of people around him getting swayed by nationalist pride, even when looking for original sources. So you can see that the contestation is with another form of history writing that is already happening and would snowball in his time, which had to do with assertion of religious regional identity, eventually religious identity and caste identity. And he was clearly taking a position, or even nationalist identity in a particular form, and he was clearly taking a position against what he was seeing around him. And that's a theme I'll come back to. "What is the method for ascertaining historical truth?" he asks and says. "Firstly," so this is where history writing becomes a work of self-preparation. And that's why in Sarkar you can't actually quite distinguish between his method and the development of his own character, his self-development of his own character, which is, I think, one reason when Sarkar is remembered, people remember anecdotes about him. Because eventually he became quirky. He became quite quirky. I mean, anybody who insists on having a character in the end must become a crank. Particularly today, I mean, it's impossible to have a character. But anyway, what is the method? So he asks and he answers. "First, one has to prepare one's mind for this task. Casting aside the greed for fame, wealth, or power, suppressing one's own feelings of attachment, that is, bias or anger, abandoning all previous prejudices, one has to firmly resolve, and then he quotes Rabindranath, Mora Shottir Pore Mon, Aji Koribo Samorapon, Jay Jay Jay. You know, this whole word Satya, I think, at the end of the 19th century, is a critical word, for people who do conceptual history and look at, if you want to do a lexicon of Indian nationalism, then Gandhi Satyagraha, Dayanand Satyaj Prakash, the way that Jagdish Bose used to think about Satya. Satya is a critical word, and it takes on things from both positivist ideas of truth, but it also takes on things from Shankaracharya's Vivek Churamani, the discussion of the Gita, all those things go into it. So he found this Tagore song which he quotes, and he says, almost as a pledge, you know, when I was in the Nehru Memorial Library this morning, Mahesh Rangarajan was working on a pledge he was going to administer, which was about everybody pledging not to be corrupt in the Nehru Memorial Library. So I said, what kind of corruption will you have in the library? And he said, what kind of corruption do you think we can? So I said, no, the only kind of corruption I've seen was in the IIM Calcutta Library, where somebody used to steal books and sell them, who worked in the library. Then he gave me a list of the kind of corruption they've had at Nehru Memorial Library, which is like, very creative and very impressive. So Sarkar's pledge in 1915 was, for historians, we will not worry whether or not the truth we seek is pleasant or unpleasant, or if it accords with or differs from received public opinion. Whether it pleases or hurts our sense of patriotism will not be our concern. If telling the truth invites taunts and complaints from our friends or societies, we'll put up with that. For that is the vow of the historian, for it is the vow of the historian to seek, understand, and accept the truth. You know, truth is a very interesting metaphysical word which had acquired a lot of meaningfulness for these people, even if it seems empty to us. So as a historian, I kind of have to ask, what made the word meaning seem meaningful? How did they experience this word as a meaningful word while we don't today? We'll have to, for instance, uproot the idea from our minds that treating the ancient stories of India, say the Ramayana or the Mahabharata, as fictional, will somehow stain the glorious image of India. We have to resolve that we will believe nothing without proof. So, you know, like for other historians too in the history of archaeology, nothing without proof became Sarkar's battle cry against the historians he was actually surrounded by. When European, you can also see, just very briefly, I'll mention that the rise of scientific history, and it's actually scientific history became legitimate even for people who were investing in regional identity. So Rajwade would be claiming to write scientific history. The Pune historians, who would be very upset by the James Lanes of all ages, always claim to write scientific history. But the rise of the legitimacy of the expression scientific history actually comes at a phase which distinguishes, I think, the end of the 19th century from the first half of the 19th century. Because if you go back to the first half of the 19th century, there's much more give and take between the histories that Europeans wrote of India and the existing genres of history. So for instance, if you look at John Malcolm's Memoirs of Central India, 1823, and look at Malcolm's discussion of Ahullabai of Indore. Now, Malcolm, for his time, when he went to Indore, found that the Rani was more remembered than documented. So in a sense, but he had no compunction actually about using memory of the Rani in the text without wanting to distinguish it from history. Or if you look at James Randruff's History of the Marathas, which is 1826, you'll find many parts are actually reports of conversations between him and somebody. James Todd's book on Rajasthan, the traffic, like Todd was borrowing from Rajasthani bards, and then Todd was in turn borrowed on by Kaviraj Shamaldas writing Veer Vinod in 1886. So this traffic between genres of history writing in India and European writing of Indian history, that traffic was broken by the rise of the legitimacy of scientific history and Ranka becoming almost a household name, so that the older Bhandarkar, the Sanskrit Bhandarkar, was called the Ranka of Indology. Sarkar would be described as the Ranka of Indian history. So in a way, it sort of coincides with what Tapati Gohatakurta calls the denigration of native knowledge. But more was at stake here than simply European prejudice. Sarkar was against partisan reading of sources, and he often found amateur historians' treatment of sources too partisan, motivated by all kinds of politics of identity, from nationalist boast to regional pride. So elsewhere I've actually discussed Sarkar's, the whole debate about Shivaji between Sarkar and the Maratha historians, and debate about Pratapaditta between Sarkar and Bengali, not historians, but playwrights and others. In 1940, he writes to Sardesai, the writings of K.P. Jaiswal, though containing a few original documents, are 99% pure nationalist brag and moonshine, and you'd be well advised to keep clear of his theories. So that was kind of generally his attitude. And even when Sardesai bristled, and even Sardesai, the interesting thing is that Sardesai participated in this regional pride. I mean, he was a Maratha historian who ultimately took pride in what the Marathas had achieved. But at the same time, he was very drawn to Sarkar. And there was constant tension in the correspondence. And I've just spent time in Pune actually reading Sardesai's own copies of Sarkar's books and reading Sardesai's marginal comments on Sarkar. And there was a lot of angry stuff that he said about Sarkar in his marginal comments, which he didn't put in the letters. So the letters, he was somehow sort of, you know, taming himself, his own self-expression in the letters. And often Sardesai would bring up sources that Sarkar would completely poo-poo and say, no, these are all bogus sources, you can't depend on them, I'm not going into the details, and your Maratha historians are all wrong for using them. And finally, for example, Shiva Digvijay, Sardesai is saying, look, but Shiva Digvijay, the Shivaji's letters to Maloji Ghorpade, what about those? They've been fully translated in my story, etc. Sarkar replies, says, it would be a fatal mistake for you to depend on any point on Shiva Digvijay. It is opposed to the principles of historical evidence. Borrow George's, and George was Reverend something George, who was actually an Oxford priest, who himself had written this book called Historical Evidence around 1909, which was actually based on the mid-19th century, I've got the two volumes, I haven't read through them yet, book by an English politician, looking at the credibility of Roman sources. And George was more or less summarizing that mid-19th century book. And Sarkar says, look at that book and read it through. The legal principle is, again from the police first information report to the court, the legal principle is false in one, false in all. So if you once told a lie, I'm not going to have anything to do with it, do with you, you know, when I encounter you next. Such witnesses are totally rejected. So Sarkar's moral idealist position on historical research and objectivity actually entailed a struggle, as I said, with his own present, with the discipline of history as it was actually finding a home in Indian universities in the 20s, 30s, and later. And this was ultimately reflected in three of his rejections of the idea of profession. But before that, let me just go through some of the pictures I have for you. Now, these pictures, by the way, all these pictures I owe to the Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Calcutta, which was housed initially in Sarkar's own house, Jadunath Bhavan. When they occupied the house, they found these pictures in a pile of rubbish. And now they're preserved in their archives. So that's a very young Sarkar. But talking about character, now look at that spine. It's the most uncomfortable position that you could assume in sitting. But that spine is not incidental. Sarkar later on actually would praise a particular Maratha historian, I think Khare, I forget who, for his erect spine. So there are two other people that Sarkar writes about whom he physically finds admirable because they walked erect. And that spine took training. And that posing is surely making a statement. That's Sarkar as the Vice Chancellor of Calcutta University, and that's Sardesai in 1892. So one of the things that happens with this, of course, because Sarkar and Sardesai are building up these values in the 20s, the first Indian History Congress happens in 1935 and is actually organized in Pune by the historians that Sarkar and Sardesai were fighting. Sarkar wholeheartedly and Sardesai half-heartedly, because he also kind of belonged to them. Now, the man who emerged as two people Sarkar came to hate. One was Dattavaman Poddar, who took charge of the Pune Itihash Mandal after Rajwade died. And Rajwade was a funny character because he had, you know, there are 20 volumes of his writings. Rajwade took a vow that he would never write in English. And eventually set up an ashram in Dhulia, which is where Rajwade's remains, his papers are. But Baman Poddar and the Bengali historian Surendranath Sen, who was the first director of the National Archives, because he was the first Indian keeper of records of the Imperial Records Department. Suren Sen and Poddar, so Suren Sen from Calcutta, Poddar from Pune, and Shafat Ali Khan from Allahabad University, were the three key people who put together the first Indian History Congress. So when Sarkar and Sardesai are writing about genuine researcher, research as this moral value, truth as this completely non-instrumental thing, there's Indian history happening, not simply amongst the people who are writing popular histories, but also now leaking into universities. And Allahabad comes up as one of the most important institutions because the first journal of modern Indian history, which is called Journal of Indian History, is published from there, Shafat Ali Khan as the editor. And then it runs out of money, so it has to go down to Madras, and it's still coming, still comes out of Madras, I believe. And these people actually are creating history as a profession. So in a way, if Sarkar is talking about history as a, you know, Weberian sense as calling, that you get called to do history because you get called by this idea of truth, what was happening on the ground was actually the creation of the occupation as a profession, whereby you'd go into a university, do BA, MA history, and do PhDs. And in the 1930s, PhDs are being done. And Sarkar, for him, this, it's very interesting the debate that goes on around these developments. So ultimately, I think his Sarkar's position rejects three rejections marks Sarkar's position. And the rejections, he rejects the profession of history as it evolved in India. He rejects the nationalist movement under the leadership of Gandhi, and the general Indian historical world of historical scholarship in favor of an ideal republic of letters that he would often equate with an idealized Europe. But here, the story is more complicated, actually, than it seems at first sight. The first professional meeting of the Indian historians, as I said, was 1935 in Pune, and involved these three people. Sarkar did not consider any of them, Dr. Vaman Poddar, Suren Sen, and Shafat Ahmed Khan, true researchers. Sardesai also expressed the same sentiment in a letter of 1937. Sardesai writes to Sarkar saying, as usual, the Mandal people, Poddar was being the leader, have been assiduous in their attacks upon you and me. I think it is time, a time has come when you speak out to the whole Indian world how these people lack the real historical spirit and scholarship. The more idealistic figure of the true researcher often combined with a general condemnation of their character in the language of Sarkar and Sarkar's private criticism, showing the extent to which the idea of research was laden for Sarkar with a moral significance. One accusation they privately leveled against young historians who started the Indian History Congress was that they were all talk and little work. The show at Allahabad, writes Sardesai in 1938, a recently concluded History Congress, the show at Allahabad has proved as hollow as expected. Even the promised report of the 1935 Congress has not been published, he added, criticizing Poddar. Work alone strikes and no amount of talk. So this was seen as talk fest. Sarkar had criticized the Congress in a private letter to his student, the princely historian Kumar Raghuvir Singh of Sitamau, and made a reference, I think, to the character of the main founder of the Congress, Shafat Ahmed Khan of Allahabad, where Sarkar writes, he doesn't name it, but I think it's Shafat Ahmed Khan. Sarkar says, I never attend vulgar tamashas, like the Modern History Congress or the Oriental Congress. Their standard is very low. And they're often manipulated by low self-sustaining coteries, like the Bharat Itihas Samshodhak Mandal. Even your doctor professor, Shafat Ahmed Khan had done a doctorate from, I think from Edinburgh somewhere, I forget. Even your doctor professor is an awful drunkard. At the Gwalior session of the Indian Historical Records Commission, as we were returning from the dinner at Sardar Sitole's place, he began to crow and sing, and there was every fear of his soiling my dinner suit in a fit of sickness. He stuck to this view in a letter to Sardesai on 8 September 1939 when the Congress met in Calcutta, History Congress, and Sarkar wrote, I always avoid the Indian History Congress and shall do so even when I am here during its sitting. It's a vulgar tamasha started by a drunkard. His feelings were strong enough for him to feel the urge to express them again in a few weeks' time. In a later date, 29 September of the same year, he says, I never attend the Mushroom Modern Indian History Congress. And his Betenwar, as I've already said, were particularly Churan Shen and Poddar. There's many letters, actually, that he wrote several times to the famous Goan historian, Pisur Lenkar, where he keeps asking, do you think Churan Shen knows enough Portuguese? is he simply translating your stuff into English? Why don't you write in English and throw him up for the kind of poor scholar he is? And actually, if you follow through Churan Babu's writings, you'll realize that I don't know how this relationship soured. There was a point when Churan Babu actually says how much Sarkar helped him with early work. But at some point, it soured, and it may have had to do with Ashutosh Mukhopadhyay. Again, the deep sort of Gothic scandals of Calcutta University, you know. So Sen was close to Poddar and Puna Mandal, and so these were completely, I'm just skipping some stuff. But I should clarify that I'm not really interested in understanding the psychology or motivation behind Sarkar's dislike. I'm actually interested in the language of his dislike. For the language was derived from an ideal romantic figure of the passionate, yet disinterested and diligent researcher. I'm interested, shall we say, in the social rather than the purely personal meaning that the hostility towards the likes of Khan or Sen or Poddar would have had for Sarkar. For him, the Indian History Congress was not serious research business. Oftentimes, Sarkar would express his intellectual disrespect for conferences and symposia as a form for dissemination of research. Fundamentally, you'd say, I do not share your optimism, he writes to Sarkar in 1933.